Hello and welcome to my lecture on refactoring. This is for CMPUT 301 from the University of Alberta. These slides were originally by Ken Wong. All right, so we're talking about refactoring. Well, imagine you got a pattern, basically a commonly occurring solution to a reoccurring problem. So that's what design patterns really are. It's supposed to be solutions to problems people have already had. Okay. Now we've got anti-patterns, and these are negative solutions. These are solutions that have negative consequences. These are anti-patterns. It's usually easier to recognize what is wrong and fix it than to get it right in the first place. So oftentimes you'll see a lot of these anti-patterns. In many cases, it's just a cheap thing to do and it works for now, but you end up paying for it later. So here's an example of an anti-pattern. It's a spaghetti code. That's basically code that's very complex, tangled with really complicated control flow. You used to see this a lot with go-tos, but if you use like a lot of for loops and a lot of breaks in there and a lot of conditionals in there, you get code that's kind of tangled and hard to deal with, especially code that's got multiple variables. And the result is basically, it's very hard to debug. Sometimes this is called the job retaining pattern. So people will write, people will claim that people would write spaghetti code in order to basically keep their jobs because they'd be the only people capable of maintaining it, which I kind of disagree with. Another example of a code smell is dead code. This isn't like spaghetti code. This is code that the result is no longer used. So this could be code that is no longer executed, or it could be code that executes a result, but no one ever looks at the result. So it never needed to actually be executed to begin with. So how do we get rid of these things? Well, the plan is we refactor. So refactoring allows us to change the software system so that the external behavior does not change, but the internal structure is improved. So in the case of spaghetti code, what we might do is we might try to simplify the logic or put the logic into different classes. Like if we had big conditionals about, you know, say which weapon in a game it was, maybe we just want the weapon object to deal with that instead of a big if statement trying to figure out, oh, it's actually a rocket launcher. In the case of dead code, a refactoring might be just to remove the code. So the point is we want to basically modify a software system so its internal structure is improved, but its behavior doesn't change. This is different than just like polishing up the software or cleaning up the software. A lot of people say that they're refactoring when they're bug fixing. A lot of people say they're refactoring when they're improving the software, but they're changing the behavior. The academic definition of refactoring is that the external behavior should not change. And the point is that we want to do this in small steps, and we want to use our test suite to help us do these refactorings with the small steps. Essentially, with the refactoring, what we want to do is we basically want to change a bit and then retest. Just do it in little small steps and continuously improve things. And we want to do refactoring when we want to add a feature. A lot of times features don't fit in. So we want to refactor the system to basically make that goal of implementing that feature easier to achieve, maybe by changing the system around to allow such a feature, or by improving the quality of certain things such that we don't need as many things in order to implement that feature. So before we get really deep into refactoring, we have to kind of know what stinks. So basically, Kent Beck claims, his grandma Beck has said this: if it stinks, change it. Basically, if there's bad code, if there's a bad smell in the code, you should change it. And this monstrous thing is supposed to be a baby, and it's not Tetsuo from Akira. All right. So think about this question. What are some indicators of poorly written code? Is it comments? Is it go-tos? Is it bad names? Is it a lack of abstraction? There's actually a lot of examples of poorly written code. So the whole point of bad smells in code is we have names for bad smells such that we can critique code. We can say, oh, that's a bad kind of code. That's spaghetti code, or, oh, that's dead code. This allows us to name things and also allows people to understand the problems if things are left untouched and what the cost of getting rid of that bad code is. If we have a name for it, we can shortcut our reasoning when we're dealing with it. So here's one example of a code smell. It's duplicated code. This occurs in a lot of places. Basically, it's when you have the same functionality appearing in more than one place. So you've got the same code in two methods of the same class, or the same code in two sibling subclasses. And the point of this is that duplicated code is dangerous, because if you found a bug in one, you'd have to remember that you had duplicated code so you could fix the bug in another. Essentially, it adds more lines of code, it adds more potential for bugs, and it means that if you do fix something, you might not fix all of it, which is a bit of a concern. Now, one of the solutions for duplicated code is to basically move it. Give the duplicated code a name, like a method name, or if it's a responsibility, make a class, and move it out. Basically, move it out of those methods, move it out of that class, and extract it. So two refactorings we could use would be the extract method, whereby we say, okay, this code has certain dependencies, I'll make a new method down here, and then I'll get rid of these two duplicated code bits, and I'll just call the method that I added. Another one is called the pull-up method. The pull-up method is like extract method, so you do the extract method, but you pull it up to the superclass. So if this was duplicated functionality, like imagine that these were two classes and this was the same functionality in both classes, we want to pull it up to the superclass. So the pull-up method is with inheritance. The extract method is usually within the same class. So what we want to do for extract method is just, you know, pull it out of there, pull it out of there, and put it into there, such that we now have this method accessible to us with the duplicated code there, and it's no longer duplicated. Now, duplicate code sometimes is valuable. Sometimes if you have duplicate code, it means that one piece of code is independent of the other. So if there is still a bug in the duplicate code, or there's a bug in a certain case, you can fix it in one case and it won't cause issues in the other. So sometimes there's benefits. Some companies, like banks, they record the fact that they have duplicated code, and then they keep a book and they write in the ledger. And what they don't want to do is they don't want to change code unnecessarily. So they decide if they need to change it, or maybe when they should change it. So the next bad code smell we're looking at is the long method. It's basically a long, difficult to understand method. I would say it's probably 10 lines of code or more. And it's a bit of a concern, because basically source code readability is related to size, right? So because it's related to size, we don't want big methods, because it reduces readability and comprehensibility. So what we desire is actually short, well-named methods. If it's well-named, we know what it is. If it's short, it's easy to read. We also worry that a long method is handling too many responsibilities. Essentially, could we write a separate method instead of a comment? Could we move a method around? Could we extract a method from a long method? So the common refactoring is basically just to take a very long method and then to break it down into components, component methods or functions. This extracting of methods allows you to make a bunch of small, short-named, you know, short and well-named cohesive little units of code. And it's a good alternative to one big long method that has multiple responsibilities. And by refactoring that, you move the responsibilities around and you make each method more cohesive. Along the lines of the large and long method is the large class. Sometimes it's called the blob class or the god class. It's essentially a class with too many responsibilities. It tries to do too many things. A good rule of thumb is it has four or more responsibilities. And these responsibilities might be quite separate from each other, so there's a kind of poor separation of concerns. So you could think of like a large class or a god class is something that handles too many things, like say handle map data, handle game data, provide bitmaps, provide click listeners. All of those things could be provided separately, but if you had a class that provided them all, that would likely be a large class. It would probably be a big blob. One way to deal with it is a lot like the long method, is to extract classes from it that represent those responsibilities. So basically, you write a list of bullet points about what this class is supposed to do, and then you pull those bullet points out and you make classes that are responsible for those bullet points. You extract out those methods from the large class, and you make subclasses that the large class will rely upon and hopefully delegate to. By extracting classes, this also allows you to insert, allows you to abstract, and maybe you can put in subclasses that do some of the job, and you can simplify a lot of your work. But the large class is a concern because it limits readability, it's really big, takes on too many responsibilities, it's kind of bad OO design, and it's a poor separation of concern. Next up is divergent changes. Divergent change is really about how software slowly evolves. So you design a class, and it's commonly changed for certain reasons, and you maintain the software, and this class slowly changes over time. And sometimes it goes in multiple directions. Oftentimes it ends up being a large class. But really what makes a divergent change different from a large class is that it's got distinct separate concerns that have been added to it that you could extract. So these concerns could be things like authentication, logging. They could be things like it's dealing with the GUI and I/O at the same time. And the general solution to this is to break it up. It's basically to take some of those bullet points of the responsibilities of that class and make a new class from it. So the solution is to extract class. Next up is shotgun surgery. While it sounds pretty violent, it's really about making too many changes across many classes or methods. So what I want to get at is shotgun surgery is kind of like you've got a class there, you've got a class there, you've got a class there, you've got a class there. And what makes it shotgun surgery is that when you make a change here, you also have to make a change here, and a change here, and a change here, and a change here. It's kind of like someone, you know, shot a bunch of shot out of a shotgun, right? Okay, I'm bad at drawing this, I'll admit it. So they shot it out of the shotgun, right? And it's just hitting your classes randomly, and they call it shotgun surgery. Why? Because you wouldn't do surgery with a shotgun, because it's very inexact. It's not really an accurate instrument unless, say, you use a slug. All right. Shotgun surgery, you notice it mostly during evolution, that when you make a little change, it ripples across many other different classes or methods. It's kind of bad because if that's the way you do things, then you have to keep changing things in those places. What you could do is you could consolidate these changes. And one way to do that would be to move the method around. Maybe move a method to a different class so it's responsible for it, so you don't have to keep changing that method in other classes. And then they can delegate to where you move that method. Another solution would be to create a responsibility and embed that responsibility in a new class, which takes over that responsibility. And maybe that class will have subclasses that you can specialize. So instead of changing everything all the time, you can make subclasses which you can instantiate, and they can execute the necessary behavior instead. But generally, you can usually just move methods around to get around shotgun surgery. And you've probably seen this happen just with Git version controls. You keep committing the same couple of files over and over again. The next up is the long parameter list. It's basically an issue where you're passing a lot of parameters to a method, mostly because you don't want to pass around globals. And what happens is it's difficult to understand. So I'll give you an example. So a long parameter list could be something like void draw box, and you got int x, int y, you got a boolean for curved, like a curved corner, you've got a color, and then you've got a float for the for the curve, like how curvy it is or how straight it is. Anyways, once you get to that level, it gets sort of confusing because if you've got this all named out, that's fine. But eventually people will call it draw a box. And then they'll just put an X, Y, false. And then they'll put in a null if you're unlucky. And then they'll put in like a 0.0. And you're like, what do all these things mean? They've now lost their names, right? Because you've just used very short names. So it's a bit of a problem. So these long parameter lists are difficult to understand. One thing you can do is you can replace the parameter with a method, or you can introduce a parameter object. So in this case, imagine we added the method set curve. So you can set that ahead of time. And then maybe we add set curve corners, curve. And then when we draw the box, we could void draw box, and we could go point P, whereby a point is basically and then our X and Y are encapsulated. So this would be a parameter object, and we'd replace it with that. So that would make it shorter. And using setters and things like that would allow us to basically maintain state in the class rather than this. So you see, one of the big values of classes is they do have state, and their objects will have local state, and you can set the current state, and then you can operate on that. So I just showed you replace parameter with method. So I replaced the curvature stuff with methods, and I also introduced a parameter object. So those are two possible refactorings you could do for a long parameter list. Feature envy is another kind of bad smell, and it basically, it's like a class wants to get a lot of details about another class. So it's doing a lot of work getting all this information. So in this case, we're getting an int length. So imagine this is inside a method. We're going length, width, and then we're calculating area. Well, you know, width and length are kind of properties of rectangle. Wouldn't it just be nicer to ask rectangle to get the area? So feature envy is basically where you're taking the responsibility that should be a responsibility in another class, and you're implementing it elsewhere. And then in order to implement it, you need a lot of information about it. And basically the problem is that this behavior may belong in another class. So you should probably move a method. So this code, you should extract it as a method and probably move it. You move it to the rectangle class. So this happens a lot. Lots of times you ask way too much information. So really, you just want it to be responsible for the area, especially since this is a computation. If this was anything more complicated, you would never consider doing this. Like if I asked you for circles or cylinders or trapezoids or anything like that, you probably wouldn't want to do that. Another problem is a data class. It's basically just a class that's data that tends to be manipulated with getters and setters. And the problem with it is it's not really an OO concept. It tends to be like a struct. So a data class is a lot like this point here. So what can happen is we could have the point, and then what we tend to do is we tend to go, well, we'll go 0.1x minus 0.2x. We'll go square root, or no, we'll go xd equals that. Go int yd for distance 0.1 minus 0.2y, and then we'd go something like float distance equals xd times xd plus yd times yd, square root of that. Probably use a math library. So we get the square root of that. And that would be our Euclidean distance. This code should probably be put inside the point class. What we should do is we should just extend the point class, and we should go float distance point point, then we should just refactor this to be right. So that should work. Extending the point class to have this responsibility is exactly what we want to do. So that would be basically moving the method to the point class, extracting the method, the distance method, then moving it, and maybe we want to encapsulate a field. So what happens is if people keep doing getters and setters, what they might be doing is they might be changing multiple things at once. So they might be just setting X and Y themselves, or they might be doing anything like that. Another bad smell is data clumps. It's basically groups of data that appear together. Usually it's instance variables or parameters, and they really should be a class. So if I ask you right now, what do you think an XYZ is? Maybe it's a point. We could introduce the parameter object, which I showed before. Like, we could make a point class to represent it. So we could extract a class or make a new class. But we'd still, it still might be dangerous because it still might just be a data class. But a data class is better than a data clump, I think. Anyways, so related behavior, these things are always related to each other. Pull them out, make a class that's responsible for them. Another problem is something called primitive obsession or stringitis or intitis, where people use built-in types too much. So in 301, one reason we don't use Python is because we don't want you using integer strings and dictionaries all the time to represent everything. So sometimes objects need their own representation, and maybe a lower level representation like a string is not appropriate. So I'll ask you a question. Is a string a postal code? So does postal code plus postal code make sense? No. Does the quality of postal codes make sense? Yes. But really, with postal codes, what matters is the structure of the postal code. They have a prefix and a suffix. Oftentimes, we want to know if postal codes have the same prefix. So oftentimes, we want to basically check things. Furthermore, if we represent it as a string, we are never guaranteed that we actually have a valid postal code unless we keep running this check code thing. So the idea here is, instead of implementing an actual class, people have gone ahead and they've just used kind of procedural design, and they're not following OO, and they're passing IDs and integers and strings around all the time. The solution is to basically replace the data value with an object. So in this case, we could make a postal code object. That would be one solution. Another problem is switch statements. Switch statements are basically long conditions, either large if statements or a full-out select or switch statement, where type codes define what should be done. So evaluations are done with type codes. And generally, the switch statement means you're not using the dot operator. A switch statement is investigating type, but an object already knows what type it is. So we could just go object dot the method name, and it would delegate on there, and it would already do the work for us rather than writing that switch statement. So one thing we can do is we can extract methods and move methods. So we'd probably, for every switch statement conditional, we'd extract that method and we'd move it. We can replace the type code with objects, and we can also replace the conditional with polymorphism. So replacing a type code is basically saying we're getting rid of the type code and we're just going to have the object know what it is. Yeah. As well as replace conditional with polymorphism basically is like take a big honking conditional, like a big if statement, and try to replace it with polymorphic dispatch. So virtual dispatch, like a dot operator. This one gets me all the time. Speculative generality is basically adding features to the code that you might use someday, whether a hook, abstraction, or parameter. Well, it could be really useful. The problem is it increases design complexity, violates the keep it simple principle, and just causes pain. You know, it's just a bunch of work and you got to maintain it. And you got to also do tests for it too. So one thing to do is collapse the hierarchy. So if you've got a lot of specialization, maybe you don't need it. Another thing you can do is to remove that optional parameter. And you should be able to do this because you should have the courage to do so because you're using version control, right? So if you use version control, getting rid of complexity is pretty easy. Another problem is message chains. Message chains are basically long chains of navigation to get to an object. The problem is that anything along this line can throw null pointer exception. So this can, this can, this can. They can all throw null pointer exceptions, and we won't know which one did it. It's not flexible, it's not testable, and what it requires is that A knows C and A knows B. When maybe A just wants to do something, maybe A could just know B and get B to do it. So either we do B do something, anything along those lines. What we can do is we can basically hide the delegate. We can have B cover up for C and B do the something of C. So B could have a method that calls C dot do something. And then we wouldn't have to know about C to get B to do something. Next up is inappropriate intimacy. Basically, two classes, they depend too much on each other, and they have a lot of bidirectional communication. There's high coupling between them. It could just be like they have methods in each other that they like to call, but oftentimes it means they both need each other. So this is a bit of a problem. And it means that our structure isn't hierarchical, so it means we have loops, and it makes for troubling garbage collection and things like that. So one solution is to basically move methods. So we can move this method to here. That might solve that problem. Or we could extract a class, and then the circular dependency is broken. So now A requires B, A requires C, C requires, or B requires C, and B doesn't require A. So that's pretty handy. Whereas here, A required B, and B depended on A. So that's a bit of a problem. And we are able to break it by extracting class and moving that method. And inappropriate intimacy leads to kind of issues when you're trying to maintain things. Next up is refuse bequest. It's when a subclass inherits something that is not needed, or when a superclass does not truly contain common state or behavior. So basically, if you're copying a lot of code around and writing a lot of things in each of the subclasses, maybe the superclass doesn't have what it should have. Or when the subclass now has to take on behavior you never intended it to, because the superclass has too many things in it. So that's a bit of a problem. And what you can do in this case is you can push methods up or down to push them to appropriate level, but this might result in code cloning. So what you could also do is you could replace inheritance with delegation. So instead of inheriting the code, you could simply make or have an instance of the superclass and you could delegate to it. So the difference is maybe you've got something like this. And maybe the superclass has a very useful operation, but this thing is not the superclass. So imagine this was dog, and then this was cat, and this was German, no, I can't spell that, Rottweiler? All right. So a Rottweiler is a dog, that's fine, but a cat isn't a dog. And really all we're trying to do is we're trying to get, maybe dog has a really excellent implementation of hash code. Maybe we just want dog's hash code. So what we could do, right, instead of just inheriting and being a dog, we could get rid of this connection here, and then we could say cat has its own delegate dog. And then when it calls hash code, it's just going to call dog hash code. So it'll delegate to dog rather than be a dog. So that's pretty cool. Finally, the last smell is basically comments. Comments are basically deodorant for bad-smelling code. They kind of indicate here be dragons, you know, that's a bit of a concern. And essentially what you want to watch out for is comments basically kind of warn you about certain areas, and maybe you should simplify it or refactor things such that the comment isn't needed. You should generally use comments to explain why something was done a certain way, and they're kind of dangerous. They don't stay up to date. So, like, you warn other people, you're communicating to other people that there's problems, but they don't always stay up to date, so it's a bit of a problem. If you don't update the comments and you fix it, then who knows what happens. All right, so that ends the code smell portion of this lecture.